Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for Hanning's interesting work, and her work and mine has some similarities that we both focused on the clinical workflows and conducted observation. I studied on patients who are suffering from chronic disease in the general perspective. So today I'll present about designing the clinician interface to use patient-generated data in the exam room, the title of Prescribing 10,000 Steps Like Aspirin, Designing a Novel Interface for Data-Driven Medical Consultations. So let's suppose you are suffering from a chronic disease such as hypertension and hyperlipidemia. Even though you may not necessarily require tight monitoring like diabetes, you still have to visit the doctor regularly to update your symptoms and progress. When you meet your doctor and talk about your condition, it seems like it is always the same. For example, even if you binge a couple times, you might forget about it easily, and your doctor might never know either. But what if your doctor knows that you binged and didn't exercise at all by using your data? Now we can collect various types of patient-generated data called PGD. The doctor uses this data to understand patients, make a medical decision, and give advice. So benefits are obvious. In fact, many previous studies already have addressed it. It enables doctors to give patients more precise feedback and enrich the conversations between doctors and patients. But you might know reality. The reality is always tougher than our expectations. There is too much information to handle in a certain amount of time. If PGD is used in this situation, it may make the situation worse because reviewing PGD also takes time. So doctors are too busy to deal with every single case. That's why most hospitals establish a standard workflow. Let me explain the typical example. When patient A visits a doctor, the doctor first skims lab data and secondly asks follow-up questions and then makes an order and types it in the system, like this way, and lastly orally explains the order. It's the same with patient A, B, and C, but it causes a problem when an individual patient brings in their PGD to the exam room and requests to review them. It burdens doctors with reviewing and interpreting individual data. It also causes the problem about workflow integration. It would be challenging to align reviewing PGD with the current workflow, which is already dense. So, can design solve these problems? There are two questions. The first question is about interface design. How can you design a clinician interface that integrates disparate data? The second question is about workflow integration. We try to investigate how the designed interface can help clinicians integrate using PGD into current workflow. So to answer these questions, we conducted both design workshop and in-situ field study. I'll give more details in each section. Firstly, I'll share the design workshop results to find answers to the first question. We conducted a design workshop with 18 participants of various stakeholders, as you can see on the slide. They were grouped by 5 teams in the design workshop. The workshop takes a total of 5 hours with 3 sessions. Participants sketched their ideas, discussed data representation, and voted for the most desirable one. Let me briefly summarize the results of the workshop. First, participants derived the idea of an all-in-one interface with hierarchical structures. Second, clinicians prefer familiar techniques for catching trends and events. Third, the numeric input fields for prescribing goals strongly needed to have an impact on patients' lives. So I'll give you more details about first result. This result showed that the information should be organized hierarchically on a single screen. So as you can see, all the groups proposed an all-in-one interface where all data were displayed on a single page. We thought this to be a little bit weird because considered it has not any logical reason. But surprisingly, there are two reasons. So the first one is efficiency. One of our clinician participants even told us that clicking wastes time. So one screen is better for speed. So they claimed it. And the second is saliency, which resulted in hierarchical structures. The three levels of summarization allows readily accessible information about each patient's holistic status, so clinicians may easily make sense about their patient at a glance. So we consider this point to design and implement the interface. The second result shows that clinicians prefer familiar techniques for catching trends and events. Participants drew many types of visualization sketches, but at last, familiar techniques such as line graphs, bar graphs, and heat maps were selected. On the other hand, new ideas such as a scheduled pie chart, ladder chart, and bubble chart were rejected. We thought that this tendency might be caused by the strong culture to avoid to take any risks in the medical field. So, doctors are relatively not familiar with patient-generated data compared to medical data such as vital sign. So we observed that doctors tend to apply typical medical visual term to PGD. For example, the one on the left is a graph with overlaid information like body temperature, blood pressure, respiration, and weight. It is a very typical vital graph in EMR, so clinicians thought it is very effective to visualize PGD as the same way. We reflect these points, so and thus most of the graph are lines, bars, and heat maps. Also, we created the overlaying graph despite many issues, including axis synchronization. Lastly, numeric input fields for prescribing goals strongly needed to have an impact on patients' behaviors. Actually, as it's related to the title of this paper, is the most important part of our work. So it is needed to create procedures to prescribe goals and therefore impact patients like user prescriptions. The important point is that user prescribing practices include entering input on the EMR system, which leads to standardizing the order process. The idea of setting goals by entering exact numbers was adopted. The idea was popular with participants, especially clinicians. This simple interaction was expected to help clinicians compress the discussion with patients and integrate it into the workflow. To adjust and set specific goals, appropriate criteria were required. Clinicians noted that reference values such as an average of one's data and the previous goal number are needed to make immediate decisions. But prescribing numerical goals have issues depending on goal type and delivery strategies. We will discuss later. So finally, we implemented the clinician interface named DataMD, enabling clinicians to utilize patient-generated data based on the design guidelines. After developing the first prototype, we modified it 5 times based on the feedback from the workshop participants. After modifying designs, we embedded it in the current EMR system. So it would be better to explain with a user scenario. So assume a pair of patients visit the clinic. At first, a doctor could skim patient-generated data via the numerical summary and graph with overlaying trends line. So you could say you did exercise regularly but ate too much during the last 2 weeks. Then the doctor would review a trend line for each data component and discover abnormal points. So you are usually active, but sometimes the graph significantly drops. What happened last Tuesday? And that after that, if the doctor thought it is needed, look at the heat map to check for details. you were comparably less active last Tuesday afternoon and in the evening as well. And finally, the doctor could adjust the goal with the patient and prescribe the goal. So I think a higher goal of 12,000 steps would help you take a walk. What do you think? So that's the story. So we designed the interface. So let's explore if it is helpful. So now we move on in situ field study. In the field study, we aim to trace how clinicians interact with DataMD and how it encourages clinicians to change over time. So we recruited one clinician and asked him to recruit patients interested in weight management. Most of them were suffering from chronic disease such as hypertension, hyperlipidemia, and sleep apnea. We observed 26 cases of 18 patients with DataMD and 6 cases of 4 people without DataMD. Participants with DataMD were asked to visit every 2 weeks to check their status and receive advice from clinicians. They were provided with a Misfit device to log their steps and sleep data, and a logger app to collect food, stress, weight, and blood pressure for a month. They were rewarded with a $15 gift card. We then observed the patients at the doctor's office. All the observation data were transcribed and analyzed. So let me briefly summarize the findings from observations. First, the clinician's workflow changed as DataMD helped the clinician make a new workflow. Second, counseling skills with data was improved. Third, DataMD facilitated in-depth conversation as the data itself became a conversation starter. So now I'll give more details of our first finding. The workflow is changed over using DataMD. We observed 4 behavioral tasks in without DataMD cases, but with DataMD cases, the task around DataMD increased and changed the order of the whole process. So in the new workflow, the doctor skims lab data with reviewing PGD, then 3 tasks asking to follow up questions, setting goals, orally prescribing are iterative. And lastly, the doctor type in goals on the DataMD and type in comments on the current EMR system. The next is about the counseling skills with data is improved. DataMD helped the clinician improve his counseling skill with data. At first, he read all the information on every data. However, as time passed, he reduced the time spent on reading data and started to compare data to interpret interrelations. The results of such interpretations were reflected in the goal setting. The last finding is data becoming a conversation catalyst. The DataMD interface supported and promoted doctor-patient communication within the medical office. We observed much longer and richer answers and more eye contact than without DataMD cases. These 2 conversations show the difference between with DataMD and without DataMD. So the right side is the data without DataMD. So you can see the conversation. So doctor, how's it going? Did you still exercise 3 times a week as you told me last time? Yes, but I don't have the time to work out during the weekdays. Okay, is the same that you just take a walk for an hour? Yes. So this kind of conversation consists of yes or no, or just short questions. But with DataMD, there is further more in-depth conversation. Doctor reviewed the data. I think you are doing a good job. Your average daily steps increased by almost 1,000. You got the high steps on Friday. Nothing special, I just walked back home from work. Oh, I remember that I went to the toy store to buy a gift for my son. I was lost, so it took almost 30 minutes to find the shop. So You can see without DataMD, patient just answered with a yes or no, but the interesting point was despite an additional screen, as DataMD was used on top of the EMR, more eye contact was observed while using both systems compared to when the clinician only used the EMR. So there are four discussion points, but due to the time limit, we would like to talk about the first two points. The first point is there is a tension between conventional medical data and the new patient-generated data. Doctors consider PGD and medical data to be totally different. They hesitate to use PGD actively instead to rather use it complementarily. They think PGD is better than nothing, but not the necessity. This point should be considered to design clinician interface using PGD. And the second point is how to deal with prescribing goals. So it is very important issue for an initiative issue and goal type flexibility issue and conveying strategy issue. So there are three types of issues in these discussions. So, and now we are preparing next steps. So this study is still ongoing. We investigated the patient side through the interviews and app log analysis. We also test new possibilities to convert numerical goals to natural languages through a chatbot. We are preparing next steps. Thank you for your attention.
Interesting talk. Thank you very much. My name is Jochen Meyer from Office Institute for Information Technology in Germany. What is, do you have any experiences on the professionals, on the doctors' trust towards the correctness of the patient-generated data, like incomplete data, incompletely wearing the activity tracker, faulty blood pressure measures, and all these types of stuff?
You got a very critical point. So I did not have any professional some kind of education, but I as I talked about in the presentations, patients were asked to collect SIGCHI data through apps and Misfit device. So it is very untrustful, and doctors do not believe the validity of those data. So we have some trouble, but I think it is it would become overcome during time, because the sensing technology will be increased, improved time by time. So yes, that's my answer.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Hi, Sean Munson from University of Washington. Thanks for this work. One of the things I was interested in this work is that a lot of the initial expectations from the doctors were on trend lines and quantitative data, and that was kind of where the design went. But then when you started showing the conversations, a lot of it is around the behaviors and the experiences behind that data. I'm curious, going forward, how you see kind of weighing off the quantitative summarization versus the qualitative or supporting qualitative recall.
And that's quite difficult, because we always consider about it, because you said, it is the risk of data aggregation too much, so it leads to the risk of selectivism, some kind of, and you just take a walk and healthy food like five times, so they just achieve the goal and yay, it's over. So it is important to not just numerical goal and not just use quantitative data. It also needs it to qualitative data. So it is kind of difficult to balancing between two of them. So.
you have any thoughts on how we might better support that? I think it's a real challenge, right? Because as you point out, they have no time in the meetings.
So actually, you may surprise because in Korea, average time of medical consultation on 4 minutes. So it would be never supported by some kinds of very long qualitative conversation, as just this much is quite enough for Korean doctors. So maybe we would improve our solution, but it's difficult.
Thanks.
So just very quick, more a point than a question, that I've done some similar work with teenagers and gathering their data about carrying medicines. One word of caution when you're doing your patient work, they were horrified at the prospect of doctors having access to their tracked data without them curating it. A few of them were happy to take that data and show it to a doctor in a consultation, but almost 100% would not let a doctor have access to their data before a consultation. So be very interested to see if you find similar things when you're doing work with the patients.
Yes.